Almighty God, you pour out on all who desire it the spirit of grace, generosity, and humility. As we examine your word, we ask that you would deliver us from cold hearts and wandering thoughts, so that with steady minds and burning zeal, we may serve you to the glory of Christ, our risen Savior. Amen. This is going to be our final week in the book of Acts for a while. You know, we are transitioning. Next Sunday is the beginning of Advent. And by the way, we will be working, as the cycle goes, we will start in the Gospel of Mark again. So it's Matthew, Mark, Luke, and then there's sections of John that get read in between all of those. But so this year the emphasis has been on Mark, or Matthew. Next year it's going to be on Mark. So that is what starts with Advent. But that's a gospel reading. But so we're going to focus more on some seasonal things as we enter into Advent, and then we will return to Acts once the new year starts again. But this morning, we, in our final time with Acts for a little while, are going to be looking at Acts 20, 28 through 38. Acts 20, 28 through 38. Watch yourselves and the whole flock in which the Holy Spirit has placed you as supervisors to shepherd God's church, which he obtained with the death of his own son. I know that after my departure, savage wolves will come in among you and won't spare the flock. Some of your own people will distort the word in order to lure followers after them. Stay alert. Remember that for 3 years I constantly and tearfully warned each one of you. I never stopped warning you. Now I entrust you to God and the message of his grace, which is able to build you up and give you an inheritance among all whom God has made holy. I haven't craved anyone's silver, gold, or clothing. You yourselves know that I have provided for my own needs and for those of my companions with my own hands. In everything, I have shown you that by working hard, we must help the weak. In this way, we remember the Lord Jesus' words, "It is more blessed to give than to receive." After he said these things, he knelt down with all of them to pray. They cried uncontrollably as everyone embraced and kissed Paul. They were especially grieved by his statement that they would never see him again. Then they accompanied him to the ship. This morning I want us to home in on the words of verse 35 where Paul quotes Jesus. The words that are behind us here. In this way, we remember the Lord Jesus' words, "It is more blessed to give than to receive." And I've given this message the title, "Giving is Living." And you probably think, or you have a slight idea that you're thinking that you know what I'm going to say. And let me forewarn you that probably not. You probably do not know exactly what I'm going to say. If in a few minutes you walk out of here thinking that I was talking about putting more money into the offering basket, you have absolutely missed the point, although you would not be alone. People have been missing the point of this saying, this proverb, for ages. That is, in confusing Jesus' statement with an injunction to give more to the church. Now, don't get me wrong. I'm not saying that we should neglect the needs of the church as an organization. And there are some significant needs. But that's not really what this is about. If you remember from last Sunday, Paul, the apostle, the missionary, is on his way to, anybody remember where he's heading? Jerusalem. He's headed to Jerusalem, and he's taken a brief layover at a place called Miletus, which was close enough to Ephesus so that he would send for the church leaders in Ephesus to come and meet him in Miletus. Ephesus was the place where Paul had spent 3 years getting that church going, up and running, and that is about 50 miles from Miletus. And anyway, Paul is concerned about the future of the church in Ephesus, so he is making an emotional plea with them, with the leaders especially, to hang tight with the gospel. For attacks will come, he says, just as I was attacked. And then he adds, and I'm a model of endurance for you. In other words, do as I say. Do as I've done. And he's saying, I was not a parasite in your midst. And by the way, parasite is the English power word of the day for people who are learning English. A parasite, who can define a parasite? Other than looking on the definition that's printed on the message guide. What's a parasite? Give an example.
I'd say a bloodsucker.
A bloodsucker, like a leech. A leech is a parasite, or what would be another?
Termite.
What organism does a termite live on?
It lives on wooden trees.
Well, it lives on dead trees, so it's not living on an organism. So a tick would be an example of a parasite that lives on animals and people and sucks the blood.
Mistletoe
is a good example of a parasite. Because it latches onto a living tree and it sucks the life out of that living tree. Yeah, mistletoe is a terrible, terrible thing for trees to have sitting around them. A parasite is an organism that lives in or on another organism and benefits from that other living organism at that host's expense. Or, if you projected out the idea out even more, a parasite is a person who habitually relies on or exploits and gives nothing in return. Who relies on others and gives or exploits others. Or exploits others and gives nothing in return. And Paul says, I was not a parasite. I never coveted anyone else's fine clothing among you. I was never trying to suck money out of you. I was never interested in your BMW. And he says, to top that off, I worked my tail off to support myself, and I even supported the support team that was working with me. That's the ABP, the Authorized Boydston paraphrase of verses 33 to 34. And if that were not enough, he says, I have been a constant example of how you can help the poor by working hard. Do you get the idea that when you hear this, that Paul is thinking of some very specific people who have become leaders, maybe who have a tendency toward being parasites, who would preach to build a following so though they could build a fortune. Paul is saying, beware of those people who preach to build a following, to build a fortune. But then he says, and especially beware that you don't become like them. That's more of his concern, that you don't become like them. Verse 35, but in everything I have shown you that by working hard we must help the weak. Or the poor. That is, don't act like parasites who are preying on the poor and on the weak and on the feeble-minded. And don't even waste your energy complaining about the parasites. Instead, become the counterbalancing weight, tipping things in the complete opposite direction, in the Jesus direction. Verse 35. In this way, we remember the Lord Jesus' words, it is more blessed to give than to receive. It's a very interesting little line here. And by the way, these words of Jesus are not recorded elsewhere in the Bible. They aren't even in the gospel accounts of Jesus' life. As John says at the end of his gospel, he says, if all the other things Jesus did were written down, the whole world could not contain them. Jesus said and did a whole lot of more than what was recorded in the four Gospels. And here is just one little saying that did not make it into the Gospel. and that it is more blessed to give than to receive. But this Jesus proverb is significant not because it's a tidbit, an historical anomaly, because it's a tidbit from Jesus that stands outside of the gospel accounts, but because it actually captures Paul's Jesus-defined philosophy of life. Giving is living, which is a new paradigm for living. The old way of living said, he who in the end has the most toys wins. Right? But Jesus turns the whole approach to life upside down, stands it on his head and says, no, it's he who has the least in the end that is the most blessed. The person who has the least is the one who is most blessed. That's the person who has really had a life. That's the person who has positioned herself or himself in such a way that her or his life has been characterized by giving. Such a person has experienced the joy of giving. Chip Riggs, who was my speaking partner at the conference that I was at, spoke at on Guam last week, introduced me to a phrase that I really liked and which I think captures the essence of the message here. He calls it a culture of generosity. A culture of generosity. Again, this isn't so much what goes into the offering basket, but what goes on in your head and in your life once you walk out the doors and once you start rubbing shoulders with the rest of the world, where people are looking for ways to be generous and their default is not to pinch every penny, but to give as much as they think that they can possibly give, and then to give some more. Martin Luther, the great reformer, developed a reputation for generosity, and his wife, Katie, she would hide their money because Martin was always giving the money away, and she had to hide the money in the house in a place where Martin couldn't find it because he was giving away the money without thoughts of the needs of the family. How about you? When you are in a restaurant, are you thinking, what is the smallest tip that I can possibly get away with and still be thought of as civilized? Or are you thinking, what's the most that I can afford to give and which will be healthy for the server? It's a Jesus-driven change of mindset that goes on here. What if our lives were characterized by a spirit of generosity, a spirit of graciousness, a spirit that started with even the smallest of things like tipping a server in a restaurant? Or the words we speak about our political adversaries. Are the words that we speak about those who disagree with us, are they snarky or are they generous? Or the time that we give to listen to someone who needs to talk. It is more blessed to give than to receive. Giving is living. How many times does Jesus say this in so many different ways throughout the Gospels? I mean, even though Jesus didn't use this particular proverb is not recorded in the Gospels, Jesus says it so many different ways throughout the Gospel that it's just amazing. And he talks about money and giving so much. For example, the rich young CEO visits Jesus and asks him what he has to do to be saved, and then lists all of his attributes. And Jesus tells him then, give all of your wealth away, dump your stocks, and then come follow me. Now, was that just because the man's wealth was standing in the way of his relationship with God? No. No. Jesus was simply inviting him to enter into a new type of relationship, a new way of living where success or where blessing is no longer defined by what you have or what you have accumulated, which was kind of how everybody saw blessing. You know, God has blessed me with this, God has blessed me with that, God is blessing. You know, if you have a bunch of stuff, you're considered to be blessed. Jesus is introducing a new way of thinking about blessing and saying it's not what you have accumulated, but by what you have given. That's what blessing is. In Jesus' approach to life, giving is living. In Matthew 5:40, Jesus says, if you are ordered to court and your shirt is taken from you, give your coat too. Give. Verse 41, if a soldier demands that you carry his gear for a mile, carry it 2 miles. Verse 42, you give to those who ask and don't turn away those who want to borrow. Matthew 10:8. Upon sending his disciples out on a mission, he says, heal the sick, raise the dead, cure those who have leprosy, and cast out demons. And then he adds, and it's almost parenthetical, or maybe it's actually the summary of the whole kit and caboodle, he says, give as freely as you have received. You're sent out on a mission to give. In Jesus' world, giving becomes the defining paradigm. It becomes the measure of success. It's not about putting more in the offering or being more generous with what you have. It's about a whole new way of looking at life itself. It's about adopting a culture of generosity. A young boy was admiring a really cool-looking truck in the Walmart parking lot. It had one of those custom paint jobs, and the owner had parked it way out, away from the store, and he had actually parked it across 3 parking spaces so that nobody could scratch it. And this just made it stand out all the more when the kid from the neighborhood was riding by on his bicycle. And so he stopped to take a closer look at this really cool-looking truck. It had flames and all. I mean, it was just a work of art. It was beautiful. It was this beautifully customized truck in the parking lot at the Walmart. And the boy, the 10-year-old boy, stopped. And he rode his bike around it 2 or 3 times and then stopped and got off the bike and started walking around it and looking at it and looking in the window and enjoying it. And as he was walking around, as he was looking in the window, admiring the paint job, the owner came walking up and said, you like it? He asked the boy. It rocks, said the kid on the bike. Where did you get it? The man, who was barely a man, he was just 18, 19 years old, said, my brother gave it to me. He started this computer company over in Fremont and made all kinds of money, and so he gave everyone in our family a new car. And the boy's jaw dropped. Wow! I wish, said the boy, and the man knew what was coming next because he had heard it so many times in the short 2 months since he had gotten the truck. Everyone says, I wish I had a brother like that. But he was wrong. The boy on the bike, a gangly 10-year-old boy, said, wow, I wish I could be a brother like that. He got it, right? For whatever reason, this 10-year-old got it. He understood what Jesus was saying, that giving is living. It is more blessed to give than to receive. And this should not come as any kind of great surprise when you step back and you look at Jesus himself. Remember John 3:16, right? For God so loved the world that he
gave
his only son. The Bible is about God giving. And here in Acts 20, Paul is saying, my life fits right in with what God has been doing. So follow in my footsteps if you are going to follow in God's footsteps. Don't get taken in by those bloodsuckers coming after me, the people who are pretty much into whatever it is they can get out of it, who see giving as a means or to getting, or giving as or getting as people, the church as a means of getting. He says, don't go there. Just follow me, follow Jesus. Giving is living. Well, practically speaking, what does this mean? What does giving as living really, really look like? So I've got 4 ideas I want to throw at you. Number 1, the giving life assumes a receiving life. A giving life assumes a receiving life. That is, we give because we have received. We see an expression of this in Acts 20:32. Now I entrust you to God and the message of his grace, which is able to build you up and give you an inheritance among all whom God has made holy. Paul is offering a word of blessing to the Ephesian church leaders here. He says, I give you over to God, his word, his grace, his gospel, and the inheritance that has made you holy, that has set you apart for himself. So some of you actually have the word sanctified in your translations, or sanctified, holy, set apart. They all mean the same thing. And it's language that's drawn out of the Old Testament. It's covenant promise language, contract language from the Old Testament. And Paul is applying the Old Testament promises and designations that were originally applied to the people of Israel, their inheritance as God's chosen people, and he's applying it to the church. And he's saying it's a gift. Inheritance is always a gift. You do not earn it, you receive it. And Paul is saying we give because we have this incredible inheritance from God. We've been given this gift to us. All the resources in his kingdom stand behind us. And if we give, we do not have to worry about running out because we're backed up by God himself, who, by the way, owns the cattle on 1,000 hills. Do you get the gist of what's going on here? Giving is living, and we can give because we've been given to. Secondly, number two, the giving life is a contentment-based life. The giving life is a contentment-based life. Verse 33, I haven't craved anyone's silver, gold, or clothing. I am content with what God is giving to me. So if you were to jump to, let's say, Acts 6, or I'm sorry, 1 Timothy 6, 6 through 10. This is the New Living Translation. Yet true godliness with contentment is itself great wealth. After all, we brought nothing with us when we came into the world, and we can't take anything with us when we leave it. So if we have enough food and clothing, let us be content. But people who long to be rich fall into temptation and are trapped by many foolish and harmful desires that plunge them into ruin and destruction. For the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil, and some people craving money have wandered from the true faith and pierced themselves with many sorrows. It's going to make you unhappy, let's say. Or Proverbs, or Philippians 4, 12 through 13, the Apostle Paul says, I know the experience of being in need and of having more than enough. I've learned the secret to being content in any and every circumstance, whether full or hungry, or whether having plenty or being poor. I can endure all these things through the power of the one who gives me strength. Decide that you are not going to tie your life to your level of affluence. If I have plenty, praise the Lord. If I struggle to get along with next to nothing, praise the Lord. Who I am is not related to what I have. Well, actually, that's a little off. Studies have consistently shown that people who have a lot tend to be less happy than people who have little. Although that's a bunny trail for another time. Paul is trying to show the church leaders that he has not coveted their possessions because he is content with the Lord's provision, whatever it is. He is truly free, he says. Then thirdly, the giving life is a costly life. The giving life is a costly life. Paul worked to put himself in a position where he would be able to give more. Verse 34. You yourselves know that I have provided for my own needs and for those of my companions with my own hands. I cannot remember his name. I've been trying all week, but I cannot remember his name. But I remember his story. There was a successful businessman who made buckets of money and then retired in his 40s to live off of everything that he had earned up to that point. And one day he heard the late Bill Bright the president of Campus Crusade for Christ talk about the challenges of those ministries that they had at that point. And this man decided that he was going to give, God was calling him to give Campus Crusade for Christ $1 million. The only problem was that he did not have $1 million. But he did know how to make money, so he took himself out of retirement. He started a brand new business with the sole purpose of earning money for the ministry of Campus Crusade for Christ. And last I heard, he had contributed well over $3 million. I'm sure it's got to be higher now. It cost him his early retirement, and I'm sure it cost him a few headaches. Anytime you start a business, it costs you headaches. But his sole purpose became to earn enough that he could give it away. He figured out that giving is living. Then finally, the last one, number four. The giving life is at times an outrageous life. The giving life is at times an outrageous life. I think that verse 34-35 is one of the most shocking verses in the book of Acts. And I have been a constant example of how you can help the weak or poor by working hard. Paul worked so he could help the poor, which, when you think about it, is contrary to the American way. Remember, God helps those who help themselves.
Keeping up with the Joneses.
God helps those who help themselves, which is not in the Bible, by the way. But in our system, our way of thinking, it is not the responsibility of the individual to help the poor, but of the poor to help themselves, to pull themselves up by their bootstraps. I mean, who is the ideal American? The ideal American is someone who started in poverty and pulled himself up by bootstraps. Well, at least that's how most people see it. Now, I'm not making any political statements. I'm not going there at all. And there are lots of times when the best way to help the poor is to encourage the poor to help themselves. Give a man a fish and he will eat a dinner. Teach him how to fish and he will be able to eat for a lifetime. Either way, you are giving. So I'm not really talking methodology, I'm not talking strategy, but I'm talking mindset. A way of living and thinking where we see our personal mission as helping needy people, even to the point where we work harder ourselves so we can contribute to the needs of the other people. That's not something that comes it's not something that comes out of our spare time, but out of our prime time energy. That's what Paul's saying. He's saying giving is living. That's the purpose. That's what it's all about. And I want to challenge you this morning to think again about your own purpose in life. Are you living a truly blessed life? Are you living to give? Is that your purpose in life? Perhaps you're a bit concerned about the state of your personal economy right now. Well, welcome to the club. You're not the only one. Finances are the number one stress point in most marriages. Not the only stress point in marriages, but it's the one that creates the most ripples and problems throughout the entirety of the relationship. Well, I'd encourage you to begin looking for a way to give something. Everyone has something that they can give to someone. God made you to give, and he's given you more than enough so that even if you're dirt poor, you have something that you can give. And I'd encourage you to get with it, for giving is living. Remember the words of the Lord Jesus. It is more blessed to give than to receive. And that is the good news. So, who would like to add a word? Maybe a testimony or share something along these lines that came to mind.
Well,
ask a question.
Acts chapter 2, when the Spirit of God came down on those guys, you can keep reading, it says that every last one of them gave what they had to others. I mean, that in itself, there's the example right there.
It's consistent throughout the book of Acts. It's not a new idea.
Yeah. No.
And they were giving. As soon as the Spirit came upon the church became this giving body.
Yeah.
Emmanuel, welcome.
Before I came here 2 days ago, before I traveled here, I went to go to the Bible study and I paid my account and $100 I want to buy for my kids to send to Andrea. She asked me for, was it 6 months now? Do you have to buy something for him? Start for a week, the drink, the powder, she said. And I take $100 and I went to go to the shop. And when I go, I meet 2 Nigerians in Africa, Nigerians. And they come to Italy to, they want to go in December. Then he asked me if they have a luggage in the central station. We want to go to December, but we don't have enough money. Can you make some amount of money to ask for us? And then I was looking to them. Maybe they are for alcohol or drug addiction. Okay. I asked them about 5 minutes. Then I went to take them in the central station, the ticket office. I buy the ticket for them, the round trip. I have the money. It's 68 euro. They have 20 euro with them, just the rest is I have for them. Then they was happy. And they say to me, may God bless you. Because those people, if they say to you, may God bless you, they are a Christian. If you come to say to them about, to speak about in Christ, they know in Christ. Because they have a financial problem, you know. That's why what I learned, and I blessed to them, and I left. That's about giving. We have to learn. When we give more, God will bless to us.
And you were blessed.
Thank you.